Tonight on Axis TV, straight from New York City, it's Gotham Comedy Live. Get ready to laugh with Ryan Schutt, Jocelyn Chia, Fen G, Daniel Tirado, and your host, William Shatner.
All right, welcome to Gotham Comedy Live. My name is William Shatner, okay? Yes. Or as they spell it on my Starbucks cup, Willow Shitner. I mean, it's just all, I'm just kidding. And how come these coffee baristas can't get anyone's name right? Don't they teach spelling in acting school anymore? I'm just Of course, we're coming to you tonight from New York City, and there's so much going on in New York. Comic-Con is coming back this year, which means for 7 whole days, New York will be known as the city that never sleeps with anyone. Thank you. Do we have any Trekkies here? All the diehard Trekkies speak Klingon. You know, they do. And for those of you who don't know, Klingon is a language you speak when you want people to know you're a virgin. Actually, to be fair, let me correct that record, the record on that, because the going stereotype is that Trekkies don't get laid. See, but I know it's not true because I've been to a lot of conventions, and the good news is that Trekkies do get laid. The bad news is that it's usually with George Takei. But how much could it hurt? He's Asian. Oh, it's a joke. Come on. Yeah. You'll have to bear with me tonight because I'm getting a little older, you know. And the other day, my wife yelled out, "Come on upstairs and make love to me." And I said, "I can't do both." But I think the biggest challenge that I'm facing up here is that the lingo really is changing in this country. Back in the 80s, I was on a show called T.J. Hooker. Nowadays, you can't even say hooker. You have to say Kardashian. And nobody ever took a selfie. In my day, a selfie was something you did when you couldn't get laid. Of course, I didn't have to worry about that because I, too, had George Takei to fall back on. Let me tell you a little bit about me. I was raised as in a conservative Jewish household, which explains how I landed the role of the Priceline negotiator. It also explains why I've never been asked to be in a Mel Gibson movie. You know, there's a big rumor on the internet that I made $600 million from Priceline.com. Come on. If I had made $600 million, I wouldn't be hosting a show on Axis TV. I don't Axis TV. I don't even know what channel this is on. Is it on the internet? I mean, am I on the Twitter? Come on. And I should also mention I have a new book out called Leonard that chronicles my 50-year relationship with the great Leonard Nimoy. For those of you, thank you, thank you. And for those of you Trump supporters in the audience, a book is this square stack of papers that have words on it. And as a general rule, I don't like to talk about politics. It's not because I don't have an opinion, but it's because I'm a Canadian living here on a green card. I'm one joke away from getting thrown the fuck out, you know? But what Donald Trump doesn't realize is that if he gets elected, Canada's going to build a wall to keep out the Americans. And we're going to make the United States pay for it. What did get my attention, though, is that we actually had a Jew running for president, Bernie Sanders. Yeah. I heard a lot of people say that Bernie was way too old to be president, to which I say, fuck you. Bernie is 74. He's just about the same age Dick Cheney was when he ran the country. And I've heard a lot of people wonder if America is ready to have a Jew in the White House. You know? Of course we are. America's $19 trillion in debt. It's about time we had a president who refused to pay retail. You're ahead of me there. See, I enjoy doing comedy. I enjoy it. In fact, one of my favorite nights of my career was when I was roasted by Betty White and Lisa Lampanelli. Oh, yeah. That's a strange combination of women right there. Yeah. One is a potty-mouthed whore who loves big black guys, and the other is Lisa Lampanelli. See, I thought that was funny. Right? And Andy Dick roasted me that night, and I'm happy to say that all these years later, Andy still's got it. And by it, I mean AIDS. And another favorite moment of mine took place this summer when I had the chance to speak with Stephen Hawking for my new documentary, The Truth Is in the Stars. Stephen told me that he's obsessed with exploring black holes, you know. And he's serious. When we were done, he asked me to set him up with Uhura. Relax. It's a joke, you pussies, okay? Folks, if you've learned anything here tonight, it's that I'm 85 and I don't give a fuck, you know? I've lived long. I've lived long and prospered. Now let's start the damn show, shall we? Thank you so much. Thank you. We'll be right back with your next comic.
Live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City, Ryan Schutt is taking the stage when we return. And stick around later for more with William Shatner when he returns to the stage. Welcome back to Gotham Comedy Live. More great stand-up coming your way starting right now.
I bring up your first comic. I'd like to mention that I have a brand new book out there called Zero G. It's a sci-fi thriller that takes place in the year 2050. It's available in hardcover and paperback, and we're even going to do one in Braille for NFL referees. You've seen our first comic on Two Dope Queens. How about a big round of applause for Ryan Schutt?
Hello, Gotham. Let me ask you guys a question. Have you guys ever caught one of your old friends with their new personality? You know what I'm talking about? You start hanging out with one of your old friends again you haven't seen in a really long time, and suddenly they have all these new aspects of their personality that you didn't agree to and initially signed on to be their friend. You know? Like, I started hanging out with my old friends I hadn't seen in like a really long time. And we haven't had a single conversation since we started hanging out again where he hasn't bragged about his salary to me. Which, like, that's gross, right? But here's the worst part about it, is it's not even like an impressive salary. You know what I mean? It's a salary that everybody in this room can easily imagine the lifestyle it affords. And, like, I don't want to put a numerical figure on it, but for me, it's the amount of money that I need to make where, like, if I went home to visit my parents, like, it's enough money to make me stop stealing toothpaste, but it's not enough money to make me stop stealing towels. Do you mean like it's right in that range? And he's acting like it's like I actually pay for HBO Go money. I'm like, nobody's got that kind of fucking money, man, all right? Just Russian oligarchs and Saudi princes watch Game of Thrones illegally. Everybody else steals from Kyle's mom who lives in Cleveland, all right? Stop acting like you're better than us. Watch a lot of stuff. I'm a huge NBA fan. You guys like the NBA at all? Not really the best response to that. I actually saw someone actively shaking their head like he was angry that I brought it up. Well, that's a shame, because I'm just going to power through that fucking joke anyways, guys. Sorry. It's the only thing I can relate to other people about. I love the NBA. It's like one of my favorite things. I only got one complaint about it. It's just like a minor quibble. I don't like that it's all in HD now. You know, like the high-definition broadcast. You can just see everybody just way too well, you know? Like, NBA players... not the greatest looking bunch of people I've seen in my life, you know? Like, you guys ever seen Kevin Durant in HD? Crowd that doesn't really watch the NBA. You guys ever seen this guy? Like, he's a tall, skinny, goofy bastard, man. You know, I know I'm not in, like, a great position to talk, but he's just got that, like... you just got that, like, Nightmare Before Christmas physique thing around, you know what I'm talking about? Like, he puts on a basketball jersey, just like a plastic bag caught in a tree branch. It's like a weird thing to look at. Like, I love LeBron, but, like, when you watch him in HD for too long, like, you notice the age of his head doesn't really match up with the age of his body, you know? It's like LeBron James, like from the neck down, he's got that, like, shiny, muscular, like, Carl Weathers from Predator body, you know? But then from, like, the neck up, it's just present-day Danny Glover. You know what I'm talking about? It's just like... it's like somebody cast a curse on his head in exchange for basketball powers at some point. I think the worst thing to do that's ever played in the NBA is retired now. Steve Nash. Steve Nash has got an awful-looking face. He's got one of those faces where, like, when you look at him, you're just very aware of the fact that he's got a skull. Do you know what I'm talking about? It's just this, like, taut skin mask over bone, you know? Like, have you guys ever seen anybody pet a cat too hard? Do you know what I'm talking about? Just that, like, he's got a face like he's just always skydiving. Do you know? Just like, there's just, like, always G-force acting on him. It's brutal, man. Yeah, if it sounds like I have weird resentment towards NBA players, it's because I do. I'll tell you why. Not too long ago, I went home for, like, a family reunion. And when I was there, my uncles, like, all confronted me and insisted on telling me that when she was my age, my mom used to bang just like a ton of professional athletes. Yeah. Some heavy shit to drop on your nephew, I feel like, at, like, his baby cousin's birthday party. It's just how my family delivers news. That's been a part of getting older that I haven't liked, by the way, is just my family slowly revealing its horrifying past to me, you know? Like, my family treats its awful secrets the same way the government does with declassifying information. Like, they feel like because 4 decades have passed, they can now open the file on my mom's activities during the 1976 All-Star Weekend, you know? Like, I don't want to say who she, like, what I will say, I'll say this about it. It's like, my mom, like, she's like a pretty good-looking woman. But the thing about it is she's not, like, consistently pull-down professional athlete dick good-looking. So, like, what that tells me is, like, the way that she made the groupie squad was just through coachability and hustle. Like, I don't want to know that. What about my mom, man? Like, I don't want to tell you who she got involved with, but, like, I will say I can't watch ESPN Classic now without walking around, like, angry for, like, a week afterwards. Like, they played one of those NBA top 50 players of all time reunions, and, like, I almost bit through my cheek in a rage. Like, I said, fantasies of, like, rolling up in those reunions now and just being like, why the fuck didn't you call her back, Julius? It's not healthy. You guys fuck with nature documentaries at all? Clearly, I like things that just the general public just is not like. Just, I don't know why I feel like having, like, a conversation in public is gonna go better than it does in bars. Like, it's just, this is, you guys are seeing how every conversation with another human being goes from in a bar. Strained, and everybody wishes it's over really quick. Well, I love nature documentaries. It's one of my, all right. All right, this just feels patronizing now. I love them, man. Here's the thing. I feel like people that make nature documentaries, like, they don't get nearly enough credit, right? So it's like an impossible job to make a nature documentary and no one cares. It's so hard to do that job. In my book, the people that make nature documentaries, they're saints, man. Like, they gotta be to do that job every day, day in, day out, and not freak out just like all the time. It's like, if the people that made nature documentaries had my personality, you'd be watching one and the narrator would just be like, this is the Andean spotted panther. We spent over 7 years in the wilderness just to capture one glimpse of this elusive cat. No one has captured him on film before. Did you hear what I said? I said 7 years in the wilderness just to capture one glimpse of that fucking cat. I was away from my family for 7 years. I missed the birth of my son. He calls me David now, not Dad, David, because I missed his birth. You kind of fast forward to hopefully skip the breakdown, and just like, 7 years I was in the wilderness, why? I went to Juilliard for Shakespeare. What am I supposed to be doing with my life right now? This isn't even my real accent. I'm from Jersey, man. They just pay more if you sound British. It's fucking bullshit. And you fast forward again, it's like, I don't know what happened, man. I was supposed to be in movies by now, but it didn't work out. Our plane crashed in the Andes, man. It was terrible. We had to eat one of the camera guys. He was my best friend, but he was the weakest butt. Everybody at home was watching like, I don't understand why he sits on smoking weed before watching. He's really backfiring on us right now. I read a lot of self-help books, if that isn't immediately apparent already. I don't like them, man. I've read so many of them that, like, I know what the formula behind, like, every single one of them is. I'll tell you what it is. All self-help book authors are just batshit crazy. They're completely nuts. But they're also geniuses because they realize that all they got to do, right, like an unbelievable self-help book, is take all the crazy, narcissistic rants that are playing on loop in their head 24/7 and switch out all the I's and me's with you's and yours, right? It's like, for example, like a book called Behold Your Glory. It's a great title for a self-help book. Even the original title, Behold My Glory, that's just like something somebody yells before they shoot a politician. You mean that's really like a great self-help book title. There's other books in history that were almost self-help books. Just like a little tweak would have made them that way, you know? This didn't make it. Like, for example, Mein Kampf. It's a book written by Adolf Hitler, one of history's best known, most evil, most irredeemable psychopaths. Your Kampf. First ballot Oprah's book club, I guarantee it, man. If you take that book and you switch out the word Jews with the term self-doubt, it becomes a really uplifting read, man. All right, that's it for me. I've been Ryan Schutt. Thank you so much.
Live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City, Jocelyn Chia is taking the stage when we return. Stay tuned for more laughs on Axis TV.
Now, this next comic is about to make her television debut right here at the Gotham. Gosh, I remember my television debut. Wow, I was nervous and sweaty and out of breath, and that was just on the casting couch. Yeah. That guy was just. How about a nice hand for Jocelyn Chia?
Thank you so much, everyone. So I am from Singapore. Yep, that never gets a woo. Oh, too late, guys. I came to America for college. I went to Indiana. And the first thing I learned was that, man, y'all cannot tell Asians apart. I learned this because back in college, when I go to the bars with my Asian posse, we could all get in with just one ID. We use my dad's ID. I had an American boyfriend in college. His name was Michael. He went to Harvard. And my mom didn't like that he was a white guy, but he went to Harvard, right? So that makes him half Asian. First time we slept together, halfway through, he went, "Who's your daddy? Who's your daddy?" I was like, "He's Anthony Chia." Why the sudden need to know my dad's name? You couldn't have asked me that at brunch? Do you need him to find you an internship? So I end up saying to him, "Who's your daddy? Who's your daddy?" Because I realized I needed an internship. And now I work for Michael's dad. So in Asian culture, we don't take compliments very well. When someone compliments us, we'll deny it and return the compliment back even more. So for example, if you, white guy, if you were to tell me that I'm smart, I'll go, "Oh no, I am not smart. You are so smart." Oh, white guy liked that one. Don't get that too often, huh? No. When I first came to America, I got my first catcall. This guy went, "Yo mama, your titties are fine." And I went, "Oh no." Your titties, so fine. Mm-hmm. And that's how I met Michael. After college, I moved to New York, and dating's really hard for me here. This is what happens. After 3 or 4 dates, the guy will go, "Hey, Jocelyn, just so you know, I'm not looking for a relationship." Yeah, after a while, I decided to use reverse psychology by being the first to tell men that I wasn't looking for a relationship. Uh-huh, using that old noodle. And that is how I ended up with 50 fuck buddies. Yeah, that's how we do it, uh-huh. In Asian families, we don't really say "I love you" to one another. So when I was 12, I decided to tell my parents that I love them. Yeah, because I'm a rebel. I went up to my dad. I was like, "Hey, daddy, I love you." And he went, "Ah, I'm not looking for a relationship." Hey ladies, are you with me when I say this? I pride myself on being a strong, independent woman. Yeah, uh-huh. But in the bedroom, I like to be dominated. Yeah, you know what I'm saying, girl? Uh-huh. Yank my hair, spank my ass, while telling me you deserve to make 75 cents on the dollar. Oh my God, I get so turned on when the guy goes, "Who makes a whole dollar? Who makes a whole dollar?" So I have a Chinese name, Bi Zi, and Chinese names always have some kind of meaning behind them, like great warrior or future president or please, not a comedian. I was asking my parents what my name means, and they said, oh, your name means needs to be hardworking. Well, I think you guys should be called needs to be better parents. All right, what's my sister's name mean? Oh, her name means great beauty. Mother, father. I'm your firstborn child and she gets great beauty. Can we go back to the good old days in China where the second daughter gets abandoned? Like, really, do you take your firstborn child into your arms, gaze upon my baby face, and went, yeah, let's save great beauty for our second child. This one looks like she's gonna have to work hard. And they're like, Jocelyn, calm down. In Asia, it's better to be hardworking than pretty. I was like, oh, tell that to the men I'm trying to get with. Right, which guy goes around saying, yeah, I'm gonna get me a hardworking girl. I can't wait to go home tonight and ride my workhorse. Oh, hey, you know that chick I banged last night? Mm-hmm. Employee of the month. Thank you so much. You have been amazing. Jocelyn Chia.
Live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City, Fen G is taking the stage when we return. Stay tuned for more laughs on Axis TV. Gotham Comedy Live. More great stand-up coming your way starting right now.
How is it? Welcome back to the Gotham Comedy Live in New York City. Are we having fun? Yes. Just keep drinking, because the drunker you get, the funnier this shit is, okay? Our next comic is the tallest man in New York City. Give it up for Fen G.
Got to make some noise! Make some noise! Oh, I'm feeling good. I'm 27 years old, and I'm a parent. It is so hard being a parent while still living with your parents. Like now I think my daughter's growing up with authority issues. Like, it's so hard for me to tell her to go to her room at the same time my dad is telling me to go to my room. And what's crazy is that our house is really not that big. So we share the same damn room. Now we both gotta look at each other and wonder how we both fucked up. Like, this is some bullshit right here. Like, honestly, the only reason that she knows I'm her father is because I sleep on the top bunk. Don't judge, don't. Nah, I love my little girl. She actually just turned 3 years old. She did. No people clap for that, y'all. I guess I fucked up. No, that's good. But she ran up to me. She was like, Daddy, where's my gift? And I'm not really doing the best financially, even though I look so good, people understand. So I looked at her, and I'm only looking down for comedic purposes because we're really the same height. I was like, babe, we're black. You have a father that you actually know. That is your gift. And then we sat down and watched Maury together, you know, three seasons. She was like, Daddy, are you my father? I was like, I'll tell you after commercial. I'll tell you after commercial. She's still waiting. She's still waiting. But I'm also Haitian, too. I'm Haitian. Y'all look confused because I got shoes on right now. Understand? Nah, but I love my nationality. I really do. I love it. I just hate it when people come up to me and ask me stupid questions. It's like, hey, man, you Haitian? Is it true that you guys do voodoo? Now, if you ask me a stupid question, I'm gonna give you a stupid response. I'm like, yeah! I do do voodoo! And you just pissed me off. That's when I grab a piece of their hair and put it in my pocket. You see, black women really love that joke. Because they know they safe. I pull that hair. Somebody's gonna die. I just don't know who it is. White people, you look confused. It's a weave joke. I just wanted to, throw that out there. Oh, boy. 2016, I'm loving it, I really am. But I remember there was a time when it was like cool to be black. Like I remember there was a time white kids wanted to be black. Like you used to wear your hat backwards. Don't lie to me, motherfucker, don't even do that, don't do that. But nowadays, I would rather be gay than be black. Gay people have way more fun, they have parades. Black people, we have protests. I mean, at least gay parades, they make sense. They're holding signs that make sense. Like, yay, I suck dick for fun. Yay. I went to a black protest. I went to the Mike Brown protest. I seen this man holding up a sign talking about free my Uncle Earl. What the hell? And some other guy was selling his demos. Talking about I can't breathe. But buy my CDs, $2.99. I was like, this is some bullshit. That was my cousin, too. He's an asshole. He really is an asshole. You know who else is it? My friends are assholes. The other day was playing this game called Would You Marry, Fuck, Kill? Have you ever played that game, Marry, Fuck, Kill? So they're saying, would you marry, fuck, or kill Oprah? And I was like, I'm gonna kill Oprah. They was like, how you gonna kill Oprah? She's a billionaire. Why are you gonna kill Oprah? She's a billionaire. I was like, no, no, no. Every time I watch an Oprah interview, she's always making somebody cry. Like, I can't be in a relationship where I come home from work, she's like, sweetie, how's work? I'm like, work was cool. She's like, no, really, how's work? I hate it over there, I hate it! They took my lunch, I'm the only nigga that eats rice cakes! Oh, man, I can't wait till I become a big-time movie star, which is soon, but I just hate it how... Nah, I just hated how these directors nowadays are changing our classic movies and trying to force it with black actors. Like Annie, they try to make a black Annie. James Bond, they want to make James Bond black. James Bond is a secret spy. We can't even walk past the cops without getting shot. Are y'all serious, people? I'm just saying, that's gonna be a fast-ass movie. Action and cut. Scene and scene. Straight to Redbox, straight to fucking Redbox. Now, honestly, I'm just a kid from Long Island. I really am. The suburbs of Long Island, I'm just a kid from the suburbs of Long Island. And listen, I'm tired of all these fake thugs coming out of Long Island. And listen, I don't believe you can be a thug if you grew up with a backyard. Let's just cut it out, people. Now my best friend wants to be a rapper. Talking about I sell rocks. I'm like, my nigga, we used to sell Pokemon cards together, don't you remember? Cletus, you got a garden. You can't be a thug with tulips. It doesn't work. It doesn't work that way. Oh, man. When I'm not doing stand-up, I'm really just a front desk agent at a hotel. I really am. And I just started. The other day, the craziest thing happened to me. The shit was fucking crazy. This guy came in, he looked really nice, and he smelled really damn good. Yes, he smelled really goddamn good. So he said, "Fan, I want the best room possible. I'm nice at what I do, so I try to provide him with the best room possible." So he gave me his card, and the shit declined. Now, this never happened to me before, because this man was white. And I didn't know if this was still part of the orientation process. And I didn't want to lose my job, so I was like, "Sir, you can have your room. I'm gonna use my card. We're gonna figure this shit out in the morning." Then my card declined. I was like, "This is some bullshit right here." Oh man, so it sucks that I gotta leave you guys so soon, but I'm kind of tired. Like, I'm mad that you white people are not intimidated by me. It really hurts me. No, there's no way I should be walking in Brooklyn late at night in Flatbush, and you guys just hand me your purse and your phone and tell me to take a picture of y'all. Y'all don't do that to nobody else. Why me? So now I got all these phones at my house, and I don't know what to do with it. I really don't. Oh, boy. Oh, my God. You put first, Dunkin' Donuts or Starbucks? Dunkin' Donuts or Starbucks? Doesn't really matter. I'm going with this anyway. I really hate Dunkin' Donuts. I hate Dunkin' Donuts. I'm never going there again. I'm never going there again. The other day, I went to the drive-thru. I asked for two glazed donuts, two glazed donuts. This man gives me a Boston cream. Now, I never had a Boston cream before. And you know when you're driving, you're really not paying attention. So I reached in the bag and, ladies, I know why you don't like sucking dick. There's no warning sign. This donut just came in my mouth. I was like, tell me. This donut didn't just come in my mouth. What's crazy is that I kept eating it. Does that? Anyway, that's my time. My name is Fen. Thank you. I appreciate it.
Live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City, Daniel Tirado is taking the stage when we return. Stay tuned for more laughs on X's TV.
Great. Are you ready? Are you ready? Are you ready for your final comic of the night? You've seen him on Stand Up NBC. He's making his second appearance on the show. Give it up for Daniel Tirado.
So, my son just turned two. And I'm very happy. I am Polish-Peruvian. My wife is Japanese-Egyptian. Yeah, we wanted to create a superhero. This kid is adorable. Obviously, I'm gonna say that's my kid. You know, I was in the subway, I was holding him, and this gorgeous woman came up to us, and she said, what a cutie. Tell him to give me a call in 20 years. I said, lady, 20 years from now, he's gonna look exactly like me. So why don't I just give you my number? She laughed, I laughed. And I went back home and I really processed what she said, right? Deeply disturbing when you think about it, because essentially what she said was, when your baby is old enough to fuck, I want to fuck your baby. And it was totally acceptable because a woman said it, right? Because you'll never see a guy go up to a baby girl and be like, hey, what a cutie. Tell her, give me a ring-a-ding-ding. And what did she expect? Right, 20 years later, she gets a call from my son. Hey, remember me? How's that cute baby sit on the L train? So, we gonna fuck or what? It's crazy having a kid in New York City, so expensive. Daycare is actually the cost of rent. So we're thinking next year, instead of putting him in daycare, we'll just get him his own apartment. Right? I hated picking my son up in daycare because I would always bump into this one very competitive dad who was convinced his kid was a genius. Just like a couple of weeks ago, he was like, in front of all the parents, I just taught my 2-year-old to count up to 10 in Spanish. Why don't you go ahead, Yuka? And she went, uno, dos, tres, cuatro, cinco, seis, siete, ocho, nueve, diez. And right then and there, my son spotted me, and he got all excited, and he went, it's like, yeah, well, my son knows Morse code. Feel sorry for your stupid baby. Mine's a genius. I miss it when he was little, right? When he was a little baby, we used to play a lot of pranks. I remember once my buddy Andy came over to my place and he started sexting this girl. And she sent me a picture of her chest. So the next obvious move is for him to send a crotch shot, right? Which is not gonna happen in my apartment. So I was like, yo, Andy, how awesome would it be if instead of sending her a picture of your crotch, we sent her a picture of my baby's crotch? And then you text her, just shaved. Not even hard yet. All right, that joke's not for everyone. Just those with a good sense of humor. I am a Canadian, and thank you. I think we have a reputation of being very polite people, right? And it's so embedded in our thinking. Like, I was walking down the street and I saw a crossdresser, and in my head, I didn't know if that's a transvestite, a transsexual, transgender, like so many words. I think we should simplify it, pick one, and call them all transformers. Because that's what they are, right? They transform themselves from one being into another beautiful being. But sometimes that being is so beautiful that you can't even tell what they were originally. And those should be called Decepticons. I don't know what to say anymore, you know? I don't want to offend anyone. Like, Caitlyn Jenner now has grandchildren. Do you think those kids know what to call her? They're like, hey, granny. She's like, ah, that's rude. It's transvestite. I'm afraid of offending my own kid. We're letting his hair grow out. And a woman at a restaurant was like, oh, God, your kid's so cute. Boy or girl? I was like, you know what? We don't like putting labels on things. So, we're gonna let the kid decide. I am married, and to this, the coolest chick I've ever had the chance to meet. And yeah, she's cool. And yeah, you know, it's weird. Before you get married, you get a marriage license, which is something no one will ever ask to see again. Right? Like, if you get in a fight with your spouse, you'll never have a cop knock on your door and be like, marriage license and registration. Yeah, you know, 2 weeks later, your friend's like, yo, man, what happened to you? And I'm like, my marriage license got suspended. Had an MUI, yeah? And is married under the influence.
It's a great time to be married. I wouldn't be able to, you know, handle the whole dating scene. It's kind of crazy. Like, we can't even ask a woman for a phone number. It's like an invasion of your privacy. Right? Add me on Facebook. Add me on Facebook. That's what you all say. And for me to add you on Facebook, first I have to find you on Facebook. Then I have to send you a friend request. Then I have to wait for you to accept my friend request. In the meantime, I gotta go back to my profile, change my relationship status, it's complicated. And I gotta type you a message, you gotta type me back. I don't have time for that shit. I got a wife and baby. So. You know what? Sex really slows down when you have a kid. I remember when my son was born, it took us about 5 months before having sex again. 5 months. But when it happened, wow. It was bananas. And I remember like it was yesterday, it was a hot summer day, and my wife, my baby, and I, we all fell asleep naked, and it was hot. And I woke up and I saw her face and she looked like an angel. And I kissed her lips softly and she woke up and we started making out, like making out. And yeah. And next thing you know, we are having the most mind, body, euphoric sexual experience ever. Until my baby wakes up and starts crying. And she says, okay, I gotta feed the baby. I'm like, no, you gotta feed me. She's like, no, I gotta feed the baby or else he won't stop crying. I was like, no, this is us. This is our mom, it's 5 months. She's like, no, I can't. So she takes the baby and starts breastfeeding him while we're still having sex. Yeah, I know. And it was manageable. Until he made eye contact with me. And he was frowning too, he was like, mm-hmm. And you want to hear the most twisted part? I didn't stop. I just put a pillow over his face. I was like, he's not gonna remember, whatever. And that's when I realized, holy shit, I'm having a threesome with my baby. And I wish I would have been drunk, you know, because I wouldn't have cared. I'm like, yeah, high five, tag team, yeah. But no, I wish that wasn't a true story. But hey, you know, who knows? Maybe 30, 40 years from now, you know, maybe my son and I, we're gonna have that father and son talk and he's gonna open up to me. He'll be like, you know what, Dad? I never had a threesome. And I'll be holding a glass of scotch. Sit down, son. Have a good one, guys. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City, William Shatner is taking the stage when we return. Stay tuned for more laughs on Access TV.
People ask me all the time if I'm ever going to do another Star Trek. You know, folks, I'm old. No, nobody wants to watch the Enterprise fly to Florida for a half-price breakfast. And it won't even be called the Enterprise. It'll be called the USS AARP. You know, a lot of New Yorkers have told me that they're worried about the catching the Zika virus. My best advice is if you're really worried about catching Zika, go to a Jets game. No one catches anything there. I go. And be careful on your way home tonight. The streets of New York are crazy. I actually saw a flasher on the way here, which reminds me, did you hear about the flasher who was thinking of retiring? He decided to stick it out for one more year. Thanks for watching us here on Access TV. How about another hand for the comics you saw tonight? Come on up here, man.
Come on up here.
They were wonderful. They were wonderful. Ryan Schutt. Jocelyn Chia. Fen G. And Daniel Tirado. Good night, everybody. Thank you.